After 6 generations of 14 nanometer processors, a number that quakes every Asian grandmother to the core, because 14 subs, eh? Intel, the underdog, finally strikes back like Gearless Joe from Megalobox. Finally, 12th gen core Alder Lake processors are here with a brand new 10 nanometer process. Not exactly brand new, but don't let that 10 nanometer fool you. With a complete overhaul of the processor architecture, new features, as well as the introduction of DDR5 and PCIe Gen 5, this launch is actually a lot more exciting than you'd think. In this review, I'm gonna find out if the brand spanking new 12th gen Intel Core i9-12900k can dethrone the AMD Ryzen 950-950X as the ultimate CPU for gamers as well as content creators. Let's get cracking. For the sake of time, because some of us smaller non-Linus reviewers received our processors a little later, this TLDR review is going to be focused on two main things. Firstly, to give you a quick breakdown on all the new and important upgrades that come with Intel 12th Gen. Number two, a head-to-head performance comparison between the top-of-the-line Bangsawan consumer desktop processors from Intel and AMD, namely the i9-12900K versus the reigning king Ryzen 9 5950X in a series of synthetic and gaming benchmarks, as well as tests for video editing, content creation, and 3D workloads. A more in-depth review where we'll test out the other processors in this new lineup will be coming up soon. Also, numbers might shift a little as updates for Windows 11 continue to roll out to provide better performance and stability. So feel free to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit that notification bell to stay tuned. Without further ado, let's dive right into the specifications. Now, in terms of size, 12th gen processors with Intel's 10 nanometer super thin process are quite a bit larger than the previous generation at 45 by 37.5 millimeters, and with that, we also get an updated socket, LGA1700. Inside, these Alder Lake CPUs are unlike any desktop processors that came before from both the blue and red teams. Technically speaking, it is actually more similar to Apple M1 processors. Basically, there are dedicated performance and efficiency cores, a P&E cores for short, that split up computing tasks depending on whichever suits them best. Intel packs these new processors with something called Thread Director, which analyzes the type of task an app is actually performing, tells the OS, which is Windows 11 in this point, about it, and the OS then directs the task accordingly to whichever cores is more suitable. Currently, this is only available with Windows 11, but there might or might not be a patch for Windows 10 later down the road. Anyways, if all P-cores are fully loaded, rather than relying on hyper-threading, which are only available in P-cores, redirecting the task to E-cores might actually be more efficient, and we'll have to check out the benchmarks later to see how this actually translates to performance. I'm more excited about this new architecture moving into laptops because this would lead to a more efficient management of background tasks like a Windows update and virus scanning, as well as foreground tasks like gaming and video editing, resulting in a lower power consumption and heat output. This means that we're gonna get slimmer and more powerful laptops with better battery life. That's pretty cool. Another thing to note about these new processors, at least based on Intel's spec sheet, is the lack of a TDP number. It's actually still there, but represented by a combination of two numbers, PBP, processor-based power, which is how much power is for sure available for the CPU to use, and MTP, or maximum turbo power, and that's how much the CPU actually uses during boost. Okay, now let's talk about the elephants in the room, which are PCIe Gen 5 and DDR5. I'm not going to be able to dive deep into this, but essentially, 12th gen Intel CPUs are the first ones that come with PCIe Gen 5, which has double the bandwidth of Gen 4, meaning that 8 lanes of Gen 5 equals to 16 lanes of Gen 4, which also equals to 32 lanes of Gen 3. But for the most part, we are not going to see the benefits of this until more cards can fully utilize the tech sometime soon, we hope. As for DDR5, the short version is this. It can go faster, has a redesigned power management, as well as the introduction of XMP 3.0, which allows for up to 3 overclocking profiles to be set into the RAM itself, and dynamic memory boost, which is kind of like turbo boost but for the RAM that saves even more power and thermal output without sacrificing performance gains with the higher speeds. No drivers are needed here and everything is handled by the CPU and BIOS. Now with Intel 12th Gen, you can still use your old DDR4 memory, but you won't be able to use it together with DDR5. So you don't have to toss out your old RAM yet. Also, dynamic memory boost even works with DDR4, but it very much depends on the BIOS support of your motherboard. And for more info in this, stay tuned for our full review on our Corsair Dominator Platinum DDR5 kit. Oh yeah, we'll also be talking about the Z690 chipset upgrades in a future video, so you can look forward to that as well. Yeah, subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay tuned. Now, before we move on to benchmarks, I need to make a few things clear first. Firstly, Windows 11 is designed by Microsoft in collaboration with Intel with 12th gen processors in mind. I mean, they even said it themselves.
Intel and Microsoft have partnered together for a long time, for decades, to bring innovation to the PC platform.
If you've been following tech news, you'll know that there's a conflict between Windows 11 scheduler and AMD CPUs that causes significant performance issues. While it seems to have been patched as of today, which is the 3rd of November, it kind of renders Intel's initial performance numbers versus AMD somewhat irrelevant, and you should take that with ample amount of salt. Also, comparing numbers from our Ryzen 9 5950X in Windows 11 and in Windows 10, we still saw a performance difference in Cinebench as well as a couple of games like Shadow of Tomb Raider. For more on this, you can check out Tom Hardware's article on this. We'll revisit these numbers should a later patch improve compatibility with Ryzen. Now, moving on to the second point, and this is that Intel 12th gen processors like the i9-12900K and also the Z690 chipset are compatible with DDR5, while Ryzen 9 5950X with X570 chipset only supports DDR4, so this might not look like an apples to apples comparison. I mean, we can't even match RAM speeds. However, we're simply pitching the top-of-the-line consumer CPUs from Intel and AMD paired with the same GPU, PCIe Gen 4 storage, and PSU, so the numbers are still valid, bar Windows 11 issues, which I have already mentioned. Okay, that's everything, and here's the setup of our test bench. We're going to kick things off in synthetic benchmarks, and in Cinebench R20, with the i9-12900K, we're looking at a 13% increase in multi-core and an impressive 20% increase in single-core over the Ryzen 9. It also led by 2% in 7-zip compression, but still fell behind the Ryzen by about 23% in decompression. Overall, depending on the task, the 12900K is taking a noticeable lead here. In fact, you're looking at a huge jump, about 16 to 83% in performance over the 11th gen 11900K, definitely worth the upgrade. Moving on to gaming benchmarks, the 12900K has a tiny edge over the Ryzen 9 in all the titles that we tested. In Shadow of Tomb Raider, the i9 took a modest 5% lead, which went up to 6% in Cyberpunk 2077, and down to about 2% in Death Stranding, because that game is a little bit better optimized. And finally, we have 4% in Valorant. It also took a 7-15% lead over the previous generation i9-11900K. Finally, we have productivity benchmarks, starting with Puget Bench. The i9-12900K took an impressive 18% lead over the Ryzen 9 in Premiere Pro and 21% in After Effects. This lead drops down to a much smaller 7.5% in Resolve, because Resolve is a little bit more GPU bound, as we all know. Again, in Photoshop, we're looking at a 20% improvement, which is really impressive. For 3D workloads, while the i9 took a smaller 2.5% lead over the Ryzen 9 in V-Ray, we still saw a larger 8% lead in Blender Classroom and 14% lead in Blender BMW. Again, we're seeing a significant improvement over the 11th Gen i9 processor for productivity tasks, 18-30% for photo and video editing, and a whopping 40-53% in 3D workloads. Before we move on, let's take a quick look at temperature and power draw. With our 480mm AIO cooler and the i9-12900K set in stock settings, the temperature was idling at 30 Celsius and maxing out at about 85 degrees Celsius. In terms of power consumption, we do see an increase increase over the previous generation in max load, but the idle power draw was way lower at just about 3 to 5 watts. Do remember that these numbers are with the CPU under a full stress test. For everyday use, we should still see a lower overall average. Let's talk a little bit about overclocking. With Intel 12th Gen, K-series CPUs now come with a sustained boost mode, which is also called enhanced multi-core performance in our Gigabyte board that you can switch on in the BIOS, where PBP now equals to MTP, so you can boost forever. But make sure that you pick a cooler that can handle the thermal output. Our 480mm Corsair H170i AIO cooler had no issues running all the P-cores at 5.2 GHz indefinitely, but I wouldn't do it on anything smaller than a 360mm AIO cooler, so do pay that in mind. By switching enhanced multi-core performance from auto to enabled, we're looking at a 6% improvement over stock in Cinebench R20 multi-core and 4% in single core. It even improved numbers in 7-zip by up to 5% in decompression, and what really surprised me was the improvement in gaming. Sustaining a 5.2 GHz boost gave us a 6% lead in Shadow of Tomb Raider and 12% in Valorant. Moving on to productivity tasks, and in Puget, most of the tests are within the margin of plus minus 2-3%, so it's pretty much the same, except for Resolve, where we saw a 10.5% boost in performance. For 3D workloads, we're looking at 7% boost in V-Ray and 2-4% shorter render times in Blender. Overall, if you own an i9-12900K, just get a bigger cooler and flip on that enhanced multi-core. In case you're interested in overclocking, which hasn't been a thing for a while, Intel Extreme Tuning Utility comes with a one-click OC with a speed optimizer that adds a 100 MHz bump to all the cores. But I would still go manual if you really want to OC and are not a noob. I was gonna do a whole segment on this, but preliminary findings with overclocking tells me that most of you will probably find stock settings better for most workloads because it's a little bit more flexible. And if you're someone who needs sustained multi-core performance, just do like me and buy a bigger AIO cooler and flip on enhanced multi-core performance like we just did. Before we close things up, let's talk about the price. Now, this Intel i9-12900K is priced at $589, which is $50 more than the 11900K when it first launched. I was initially feeling a little meh about this whole situation until I remembered that the Ryzen 9 5950X actually launched at $799 and it's still selling at around that price. Looking at the benchmarks, I can't believe I'm saying this, but as of today, with Windows 11, the i9-12900K is actually a steal. To summarize, here are the pros, cons, and cons of the Intel 12th Gen Core i9-12900K processor. I give the Intel 12th Gen Core i9-12900K a super hashtag cheap buy for Bangsawan gamers and content creators. 9 out of 10.
Guess who's back? Back again. Blue team's back. Intel your friends.
Okay, that was a bad one. And if you're laughing, then you're a dad. Okay, enough with the jokes. Now, while Windows 11 is still performing a little worse on Ryzen processors, even with a 5% tolerance, the i9-12900K is still at least on par or slightly better in almost every one of our tests, from syntactic benchmarks to gaming to productivity workloads, especially for content creators and creative professionals. All that at a better value than the $700 plus Ryzen 9 5950X at only $589, or about 3,000 ringgit-ish, I foresee lah. And I'm also foreseeing a price drop on Ryzen CPUs, which is a win-win for everyone. Also, the 12th Gen hybrid architecture of P&E cores are definitely doing what Intel promised, which is lowering the overall power draw and also the thermal output while still performing way better than the previous generation 11th Gen i9. It's been a hot minute since I was this excited about a processor launch. Honestly, maybe since the first generation Ryzen CPUs hit the market. I can't wait to see where Intel takes this hybrid architecture next. As for AMD's answer to all this, I'm equally as psyched. Proper competition can only drive innovation into the products and savings into our pockets. Just let them big boys duke it out and let us all bathe in all that PCMR glory. And that's all, folks. If you thought this video is awesome, you know what to do. Leave a comment down below if you have any questions regarding 12th gen Intel processors, and we'll try to answer to you as we explore more about these processors and the entire lineup. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to not miss out on more content and more coverage on 12th gen Intel processors. And also, follow us on Facebook and Instagram so you can come and hang out with us and also see more shenanigans from the Mob House crew. My name is Shane, and this is Mob House, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye! Also not i8, what?